I invite you to turn your Bibles, first of all, to Genesis chapter 6 this morning, and I'm doing something that is a little bit out of nature for me. I prefer to be in a passage, a single passage of Scripture, and walk through those verses together with you. But this morning, by just nature of following in line with this mini Christmas series I'm doing, we're going to be hitting several Old Testament passages that take us through a wide gap of Old Testament history today. So if you have notes in front of you, even if you're not a note taker, you can take a look at the different scripture references. We'll hit all of those right in order. So if you want to flip through pages and try to keep up, you're welcome to. Otherwise, I will be certain to read all of these passages out loud. But we'll begin here in Genesis chapter 6. I've titled today's message, Promise Maker, Promise Keeper. Now, I want you to think for a moment about modern package delivery. Okay, it's come a long way. It's pretty amazing that in many instances, you can order something online, you can call somewhere and order something and have it at least within a few days, if not the very next day. But I wonder if, like me, you've ever found yourself waiting on a package that never arrived. So during my seminary studies, I would order a lot of books online, and I would have them shipped either to my home or to my office. Many times I would order them on something like Amazon. But there were a few times I ordered books that I needed immediately, and so I would have them shipped quickly to me, and I would wait on them, and I would get really anxious when they didn't show up when I thought they would. So I would get online and check my order and find that I had never actually placed the order. I was waiting for something that was never going to arrive. And whether it's waiting on a package or perhaps a person or an activity to conclude, I bet we've all been in instances where we thought the time would never come. Such is the storyline of the Old Testament. Between the time that God gave the first glimpse of the gospel and making good on that promise. If you were with us last week, we spent some time in Genesis chapter 3. And what happened is we discovered three reasons why we need Christmas. We found that we need Christmas because sin brought brokenness into the world. We need Christmas because that sin caused a break between God and people. And we need Christmas because sin caused deep consequence. And so Genesis 3, of course, is filled with bad news, but in the midst of that bad news, we also see the first glimpse of the gospel in all of the Bible. That though Adam and Eve deserved the full consequence of their sin, God forgave their sin, and He covered their shame right then and there. Not only that, that in Genesis 3, God actually promised that He would strike the head of the serpent, which was prophetic to the time that He would bring salvation to all who would receive it. So we see in Scripture very early, right there in Genesis chapter 3, that God is a promise maker. He makes promises. The question is God a promise keeper? Can He be trusted? Does He make good on His word? Now, for those of you who have walked with the Lord for some time, the answer to that question might be very, very obvious, but I want us today together to engage the span in the Old Testament of a promise being made right there in Genesis 3, but not yet fulfilled. Our context this morning is what I'm calling the entire Old Testament. Now, stick with me. We won't be here any longer than we usually are, but the Old Testament contains 39 books that are categorized primarily into five sections. So you have law, history, poetry, wisdom, and the prophets. Yet all of these are tied together by the work of God from creation to just before the birth of Jesus Christ through the context of covenants that God made with His people. Now, what's a covenant? In a very technical sense, a covenant is a binding agreement between two or more parties. And biblical covenants specifically refer to the instances where God entered into some sort of agreement with mankind that involves both promises and responsibilities for both parties. While there are many covenants, many promises all throughout the Old Testament, five main covenants help us understand salvation history. So again, the question is, God's a promise maker, but is he a promise keeper? I want us to go on a jet tour this morning of five major covenants here in the Old Testament that through these covenants we discover two different things. We discover both the work and nature of God, but we also discover a very clear answer to this question: is God a promise keeper? So if you're tracking with your notes, we'll begin with this first covenant that I note. Number one is the Noahic covenant. The Noahic covenant. And in this covenant, we see that God is merciful. Now, I wonder if you've ever played the game of mercy with another person, where you clasp their hands and you want to bend their wrists until they cry mercy or risk having their wrists broken. Crying mercy, in that sense, is a request to be spared. And through this covenant that God established with Moses, or with Noah rather, we see that God is merciful. So in context, the consequences of Adam and Eve's sin was very immediate. In Scripture, we see it through Cain murdering his brother Abel. We see the first humans beginning to multiply in number, and as they multiply in number, so do the manifestations of their sin, which takes us to Genesis chapter 6 and verse 5. The word of God says this: "The Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intention of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And the Lord regretted that he had made man on earth, and it grieved him in his heart. And so he said, 'I will blot man out whom I have created from the face of the land, man and animals and creeping things and birds of the heavens, for I am sorry that I have made them.'" And because of this, God would send a global flood that would destroy the wickedness that had become so prevalent on earth, yet he spared one man and his family. And after the flood began to recede, he promised Noah, and by extension all humanity, that he would never again destroy the world with a flood. In Genesis 9, verse 11, God says, "I established my covenant with you that never again will every creature be wiped out by flood waters. There will never again be a flood to destroy the earth." And perhaps you realize that he even gave a visible symbol of this promise. Just a few verses later, he talks about putting the bow in the sky, that when the rainbow appears, let this be a symbolic reminder that God has promised never to destroy the earth again with a flood. So this was an unconditional promise from God to Noah, and by extension, all of his descendants. For Noah and for all of those who would follow after him, there was nothing they could do, nothing they must do to ensure its fulfillment. It was valid purely in God's faithfulness and his mercy. The Noahic covenant testifies that God is a merciful God. The biblical concept of mercy always involves help to those who are in need, to those who are in distress. Think about what had taken place so far. Adam and Eve sinned against God. Did they deserve the full consequence of their sin? Yes. Yet God was merciful. And the early world was greatly wicked, and they deserved the full consequence of God's wrath. Yet again, God was merciful, and he promised to never again destroy the earth through a flood. Church, we serve an eternally merciful God. God is a merciful God. Hebrews 4:16 declares, "Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in our time of need." Isn't it amazing that the God of creation, Almighty God, helps us in our needs? Sure, he helps us in our greatest need, which is salvation, but he helps us in our daily needs. And so whatever needs you have, whatever distress you find yourself in, set it before the feet of Jesus through humility and prayer. The Noahic covenant testifies that God is merciful. Let's consider the second covenant. It's the Abraham. testifies to us that God is near. Now, there's something about being near that's special. My wife and I have spent 12 years away from home, having grown up in Benton until our adult years, after we got married even. So we spent 12 years away from home before coming back close to home here at Second Baptist Church. And I realize that comparatively, 12 years spent in Northeast Arkansas and the Metro East of Illinois is not far compared to some of the distances that you all are separated from immediate family and friends, but we did spend many years away. And so coming home has been a special thing, particularly that when we left home, we didn't have any children. When we returned home, God had blessed us with two, and so coming home is just a very special thing. And Christmas proclaims that Jesus is Emmanuel, which means God with us. And also, we see that right here in this covenant that God establishes through a man named Abraham, we see that God is near. So in context, years after the flood, pride led the people to rebel against God by constructing this giant tower. Genesis 10 tells us they tried to erect this tower with their ambition being to make a name for themselves. Genesis chapter 11. And after having dispersed them by confusing their languages, because of this, God would eventually choose one man, and he would choose one nation as the instrument of his blessing to the entire world. So take a look at Genesis 12 if you're tracking along. Genesis 12 and verse 1. The Lord said to Abram, "Go out from your land, your relatives, and your father's house to the land that I will show you. I'll make you into a great nation. I'll bless you, and I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you. I will curse anyone who treats you with contempt, and all of the peoples on earth will be blessed through you." So in this covenant, God promises Abraham a few specific things. He promises Abraham, your family is going to be made into a great nation. He says this nation will be led into their own land, what we refer to as the promised land. And he promises Abraham that through you, all of the earth is going to be blessed. Now, in one sense, this was a conditional promise. It required Abraham to do something, to get up, to go, to leave his family and his home and follow God to the land that he would show. But in another sense, it was unconditional. God's promise to Abraham's descendants to make them into a great nation, to bless all of the world through them, through their line, was entirely a work of God. The Abrahamic covenant testifies that God is near. But you might ask how? Well, how does this episode, how does this choosing of a man and his family to bless the world, how does that show that God is near? Well, in this sense, think about this. The promise made to Abraham was a big step in the direction of God doing what he said he would do in Genesis 3, striking the head of Satan. And God could have chose any means that he wanted to use to accomplish that promise. Yet he chose a man and his family be the blessing to the world. Now, if you were God, and this is not being sacrilegious at all, but if you were God, what would you have done? Well, I'll bet you wouldn't have chosen to use people the way God did. But the fact that God chose to work through Abraham and his descendants shows us that God is near us. God is a God who is near. And so rather than render yourself unable to comprehend this, by faith, rejoice in the fact that God is omnipresent. That means that he is everywhere all of the time, and he is near you in the midst of all of that. He drew nearest to mankind through the incarnation of Jesus. And if you've trusted in Jesus for salvation, he is as near to you as ever before through the presence of his Holy Spirit that indwells you. The Abrahamic covenant testifies that God is near. Let's take a look at the third covenant. It is the Mosaic covenant. The Mosaic covenant, and here we discover that God is holy. God is holy. Now, we live in a world where many people want to blend in and stand out as you find it to be true often. So if you get online and you Google, how do I stand out, you're going to be presented with pages and pages of self-help ideas on how to do this very thing. Things like know yourself and have passion for what you do. One statement that I saw more than once, if you want to stand out, you know what you need to do? Embrace your own weird. Okay? Embrace your weird. Well, God and His people do and should stand out, but of course not in the ways that the world suggests. Rather, in holiness. And through God's covenant with Moses, we see that God is holy. Not only is God holy, but He calls His people to be holy as well. Exodus chapter 19 really shows us this glimpse of the covenant. Exodus chapter 19, verse 5. God says to Moses, on behalf of all Israel, "Now if you will carefully listen to me and keep my covenant, you will be my own possession out of all the peoples, although the whole earth is mine, and you'll be my kingdom of priests and my holy nation. These are the words that you're to say to the Israelites." And so God tells Moses that if Israel will obey Him, they'll be His chosen people. They'll be His treasured possession. And ultimately, in doing this, these blessings will be extended to all people of the world. Remember, God chose Abraham. He said, "Through your family, I'm going to bless all the world." Here He is re-upping on that promise through Moses, now that Israel has really begun to blossom into a great number of people. This conditional covenant brings Israel closer to realizing the promises made by God, both in Genesis 3 and in particular through the Abrahamic covenant. In the meantime, though, God establishes here in this promise that He is holy. Now, the idea of holy is a very lofty concept. Now, that God is holy means that He's set apart, He's perfect, He evokes awe. Holy means that God is all-powerful. So the word holiness describes God's nature. It's important for us to grasp the holiness of God, for understanding who He is and the worship that He's called us to and how He works through people in the Bible. But listen, church, God's holiness extends to all of those who are His. And it becomes the goal of the human moral character. 1 Peter chapter 1 says it this way, verses 14 through 16. "As obedient children, don't be conformed to the passions of your former ignorance, but as He who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct, since it is written, 'You shall be holy, for I am holy.'" How do we become this? How do we, like God is holy, be holy within our own nature? Simply, through the work of sanctification that God works in our lives. Sanctification is a fancy way to say that the Holy Spirit works in our life on the basis of God's saving work and empowers us to submissive obedience to God's will and ways. So listen, Christians are positionally holy because God has saved them. So when you repented and you believed in Jesus for salvation, God indwelled you with His holiness positionally. So when you stand before God Almighty and He looks into your soul, you are found holy before Him. But God also desires for us to be holy practically. That is, through our behavior, through our actions and words and our thoughts. And that's an ongoing work of the Holy Spirit working in us daily to make us more and more and more into the holiness of Jesus Christ. And so sanctification, simply the lifelong process of our practical holiness, our behavior, coming into agreement with our positional holiness in Christ. That's sanctification. And the Mosaic Covenant testifies that God is holy, and He is a God who calls His people to be holy as well. Let's move to the fourth covenant this morning, and that is the Davidic Covenant. The Davidic Covenant. And in this covenant, we see that God is eternal. God is eternal. four classes one day, four classes another day. We just had them twice as long each day. And so instead of 45-minute periods, we would have 90-minute periods. Some days, those classes felt like they went on for an eternity. I can honestly remember times sitting in American history class, truly believing in my heart that Jesus was going to return before that class ended. Now, the concept of eternal is a difficult one for us to grasp, because we think in the moments of waiting, certain things will never end. This feels like an eternity. Well, the eternal is a core characteristic of God, and the Davidic covenant testifies that God is eternal. So after the people disobeyed the commands made in the previous covenant, God still went on, even in their disobedience, to make a promise to bring them back into a relationship with Him. And we see this most clearly in 2 Samuel chapter 7. 2 Samuel chapter 7, and beginning in verse 12. God says, "When your time comes and you rest with your fathers, I will raise up after you your descendant who will come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He's the one who will build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be his father, and he will be my son. When he does wrong, I'll discipline him with a rod of men and blows from mortals. But my faithful love will never leave him, as it did when I removed it from Saul, whom I removed from before you. Your house and kingdom will endure before me forever, and your throne will be established forever." So here God makes an unconditional promise to David and his descendants that, "David, your house and your line is going to rule over Israel, not just for a few years, decades, even centuries, but forever." And though this covenant was unconditional, there was part of it that did have a contingency. God said, "David, look, if the rulers of Israel in your line leading up to Christ, if they're obedient, then they and your nation will be blessed. But if not, you're going to experience curse." So in the Old Testament, we see in books like 1 and 2 Kings, 1 and 2 Chronicles, that Israel had many examples of both disobedient and obedient kings. And just as that contingency that God put in place stated, there was blessing when faithful kings led, and there was curse when unfaithful kings led. And in the midst of unfaithfulness, God would raise up prophets to call Israel and her kings back to himself during times of unfaithfulness. But more often than not, the nation would continue in its wicked ways, which eventually led to their exile, as recorded in the Old Testament. God still made good on his promise. The promise of an eternal king was ultimately fulfilled in Jesus Christ, who is in the line of David. The New Testament speaks it clearly in Luke chapter 1, verses 30 through 33. We read that, "Then the angel told her, Mary, 'Don't be afraid, for you've found favor with God. And listen, you'll conceive and give birth to a son, and you'll name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will have no end.'" Now, the Jews were baffled by Jesus. Jesus came claiming to be this Messiah that they had waited on and waited on and waited on. But Jesus didn't look anything like the conquering king that they expected would come as promised in the Davidic covenant. But still, this covenant is a reminder that God is eternal. He's been eternal in the past, of course. He'll be eternal in the future. That's the very nature of eternal. It's without beginning or end. He knew in advance the sin that mankind would commit against him, and he knew how he would respond. God's eternality is most clearly seen through King Jesus, who came through the line of David just as God had promised. Jesus came to accomplish the work necessary to bring salvation to all who would receive it. Then he returned to heaven, where he sits at the right hand of God even now. So the Davidic covenant testifies that God is eternal. There's a fifth and final covenant I'll have you consider this morning. It's what I call, and many call, the new covenant. The new covenant. And in the new covenant, we see that God is graceful. I wonder if you realize how enduring God's patience really is. Think of all that's unfolded. Adam and Eve blew it. Through four rounds of covenant, God's chosen people blew it. Mankind, including you and I, have a consistent track record of taking the love and mercy of God for granted and proving it through lives of rebellion against Him. Still, after all this, God is graceful and made a new covenant with His people. Jeremiah chapter 31, in verses 31 through 34, say this. Look, the days are coming, this is the Lord's declaration, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. This one will not be like the covenant I made with their ancestors on the day that I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, my covenant that they broke, even though I was their master. This is the Lord's declaration. Instead, this is the covenant I will make with the house of Israel after those days. The Lord's declaration. I will put my teaching within them and write it on their hearts. I will be their God and they will be my people. No longer will one teach his neighbor or his brother saying, know the Lord, for they will all know me from the least to the greatest of them. This is the Lord's declaration. For I will forgive their iniquity and never remember their sin again. So God makes several distinct promises. He promises through this new covenant that he would give the people the ability to desire and to follow him. He would change their hearts, give them a zeal, a desire, a want for obedience. He promises that he will be their God. They will be his people. He promises that he will forgive the sins of the people. So this new covenant testifies that God is graceful. Now the concept of grace is this, that it's undeserved acceptance and love received from another. And grace especially describes God's act towards sinners in providing salvation through His Son, Jesus Christ. Now again, this promise finds its fulfillment in Jesus. Hebrews chapter 8, 9, and 10 expand upon this prophecy, this promise being fulfilled. But this is all fulfilled in Jesus, as it's through Him that we receive forgiveness of our sins, and through Him we're indwelled by the Holy Spirit, who enables us to seek after the things of God, just like God had promised that He would make this new covenant through Jeremiah. All of these things come to fruition through the Savior Jesus Christ in a person's life. So God mercifully withholds from mankind what we deserve, while at the same time graciously supplying what we don't deserve. Salvation for all who repent of their sin and believe in Him for it. Church, this is the gift of Christmas. That the new covenant has come to fruition. That Jesus is the fulfillment of everything that God has promised from Genesis 3:15 through the Noahic and Abrahamic and Mosaic and Davidic and New Covenants and all of the promises in between. This is the gift of Christmas. So let's return to our original question. God is indeed a promise maker, but is He a promise keeper? Can God be trusted? Will He make good on His word? Well, the work and nature of God through the Old Testament screams yes. God is a promise maker, and He is a promise keeper. Despite our sin and rebellion against Him, Christ was born into the world to bring salvation so that by grace, through faith in Jesus Christ alone, we can be saved. And not only that, but God can be trusted and does make good on His word. We can be sure that He'll fulfill every promise that He gives in Scripture. And so in these covenants, we see some of the biggest of God's promises and how they've been fulfilled. But think about the other promises of God in Scripture. Listen to these carefully as I list them. If we take a survey of Scripture, we find that God promises that if we search for Him, we'll find Him. He promises protection for His children. He promises that His love will never fail. God promises blessing for all who will delight themselves in His Word. He promises salvation to all who believe in His Son. He promises that all things will work out for the good of His children. God promises comfort in our trials and new life in Christ and every spiritual blessing in Christ. God promises to finish the work that He starts in us. He promises peace when we pray. God promises to supply our needs. God promises abundant life for those who follow Him. God promises that He will return for us. And He promises eternal life for those who trust in Him. This is just a glimpse of the promise of God given to us in Scripture. Church, God is a promise maker, and He is a promise keeper. The birth of Jesus into the world for the mission that He was sent is proof, but so is every promise given and kept in the Word of God. And so my question for you today is, would you trust Jesus with your life? Yes, I mean first for salvation. That you would confess and repent and turn from your sin and believe on Jesus for salvation. But secondly, for the many of us who have, would you trust Jesus for every need that you have? Would you relinquish whatever is keeping you from trusting Him today? Would you bow with me? Father, we love You. We thank You that the story that You have written and made come true in all of history is testimony that You are a God who promises, but You are a God who is a promise keeper. God, we thank You for Your great love and grace and mercy. We thank You for Christmas. And God, it is my desire that for myself included this day, that we have just a clear and resounding reminder, perhaps for the first time revelation, of the fact that You are a God who can be trusted. You can be trusted in our own life for salvation, and You can be trusted for every need we have. So Lord, in this season of Christmas where we celebrate Jesus coming into the world to accomplish the salvation that He was sent to accomplish, in the midst of that celebration, Lord, perhaps there are some very hard things in our hearts and minds this day, Lord, that we need to relinquish control of and trust You with. So, Father, in the hearts of many today, I pray that You would provoke us to humility, to trust, to prayer, and to full submission to Your will and way, God, because You are a promise maker.